Good evening to everyone here this evening with us for our January Benedictine conversation entitled Sacred Selves, Creating and Becoming. And we have as our guest this evening, Sarah Brokke, and I'll be introducing her in just a minute, but we're grateful that you are with us tonight, Sarah. So I'm Dawn Carrillo. I'm the director of the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, which is a ministry of the Sisters of St. Scholastica. And we are so happy to welcome you here. We're about half, this is the halfway mark in our series this year, and we've had a wonderful lineup, and it continues with our guests tonight and following through until May. The format will be as the format has been in prior Benedictine conversations, where Sarah and I will engage in a conversation. If at any time you want to send in a comment or a question, I would invite you to do that. Otherwise, later on in the event, I will be inviting you to go ahead and send in any questions and comments that you would have for our guest. So as we begin this evening, I want to start us with a little prayer poem. Saint Benedict said that to bring a work to perfection, we should always start with prayer. We just finished up the Christmas season about a week and a half ago with the baptism of the Lord on the 9th of January. So I found this little prayer poem to use with you tonight, and it's actually written by a man named Howard Thurman, who was a theologian and a mentor to many civil rights activists, one of whom was Martin Luther King. Howard Thurman was a key mentor for Martin Luther King, whose birthday, of course, we celebrated yesterday. So here's the prayer to start this evening, and it's called When the Song of the Angels is Stilled. When the song of the angels is stilled, when the star in the sky is gone, when the kings and princes are home, when the shepherds are back with their flocks, the work of Christmas begins. To find the lost, to heal the broken, to feed the hungry, to release the prisoner, to rebuild the nations, to bring peace among the people, and to make music in the heart. Amen. And so tonight, I think you will agree as you leave here this night that you've heard music in your heart after our conversation with Sarah. So I'd like to introduce Sarah. Sarah is an associate professor of art at St. Scholastica. She's also the director of the art program and the mural initiative program at the college. She's been teaching at the college since 2005. She studied for her degrees at University of Minnesota Duluth. And since she's an artist, she had the wonderful gift of studying in Florence, Italy, and also in Bowling Green State University in Ohio. And so just before we got on tonight, I was chatting a little bit with Sarah because there's been a book of her paintings that was published in 2016. And she told me that what this book was, she had done 36, she had painted portraits of 36 local artists. And it became a book, and then it became a documentary. So that's wonderful. She's received awards and fellowships Those of you who were involved in participating in our October Benedictine conversation with Gary Bolhauer, we started that evening with a children's book that he wrote called A Common Thirst. Well, Sarah did the illustrations for that book, and we'll be seeing some of that tonight and talking with her about it. And there's been several awards with that book too. So she has exhibited nationally and internationally, and her work today focuses on the intersection between nature and humanity and seeking the sacred in all beings. Sarah, welcome. Welcome to this evening with us.
Thank you. I am deeply honored to be here with you, and I'm very much looking forward to our conversation.
Wonderful. So when we do these Benedictine conversations, our participants love to hear about who is this person, who is our guest. And so I just want to start out, Sarah, with anything that you want to say to us about how you became interested in art. What brought you to this place today?
It's a really good question. It's been a few years, so not to give everyone more information than anyone maybe wants to know, but I would say my mom would probably say that I've been interested in making things since I could hold a crayon. I've always drawing as a kid. I remember distinctly I had a first grade teacher that drew her own coloring sheets, and I just thought that was like magic. Like, I wanted to learn to do that. And so that idea of creating something out of nothing, felt like a really powerful and interesting thing for me as a child to understand. And then I think when I was 8, my mom and my aunt brought me to the Minneapolis Institute of Art. I'm actually from North Dakota, so this was a big trip for us. And we went and saw an Impressionist exhibition, and I thought, wow, if I could do that, that would be incredible. It didn't even occur to me that I could do that, but just the awe and the wonder of it, I remember really having a big impact on me. But then throughout my growing up, I wanted to be all kinds of things. I was interested in being a lawyer, being a doctor, being a pastor at one point, all kinds of things. But there was a common thread that pulled through all of it, in that I really wanted to work with people and help people and connect with people. And so where I'm at today, of course, is that I'm doing both things. I'm teaching, which I'm deeply passionate and feel called to do, and painting, which feels kind of miraculous. And I'm so grateful to be able to do it every day.
Wow. Was there any kind of pivotal point that helped you just zero in on artistry? I think I remember you saying to me at one point that you didn't realize that a person could actually do art as a job.
It certainly was not part of the narrative that I was brought up with, and that is no negative things towards my family or of origin or anything like that. It just, I didn't see the example of it. My mom is incredibly creative in all kinds of ways, but I thought creativity and art was perhaps a hobby or, you know, something that you do in addition to your career. And then my sophomore year of my undergraduate work, I went and studied in Birmingham, England for a full year. And while I was there, I was just separate enough, I think, from all the things you're told when you're growing up about who you are and what you should be and what you're good at, to really know that I really wanted to make art as part of my life. And I really wanted to teach as part of that, help other folks on their path, whatever way that would be. And within that, I thought that I could then be a part-time artist and a part-time professor. I thought that makes a whole thing, but it turns out that's not a whole thing that many folks are able to do. And so I'm a full-time professor and a full-time artist. And that means I'm very busy, but yeah, loving it all. That is for sure.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you for that background. I'm curious myself with this next question, because everyone probably answers this a little bit differently, and you're a professional artist, so I'd love to hear how you answer it. What does it mean to you to be an artist? What does that mean?
It's a really complex word in a lot of ways, isn't it? I mean, I've had students over the years that I certainly deem as artists, but even owning that or claiming that word, particularly in our, you know, perhaps it's in our culture in the United States, who knows what it is, but it feels like an ownership of something that maybe someone has to deem that you are. But I would say that anybody who creates is an artist, has the act of creation, the act of making, whether that's a painting like I do, whether that's an incredible garden, there is artistry and creativity. And I feel like it's deeply human to be an artist, to be creative. Mm-hmm. And so I always try to encourage, you know, all my friends and folks to take part in that word, because words can be really powerful, and owning that you are an artist can also do something really wild where it like opens up space for you to engage with that part of yourself. Mm-hmm. I think it's very healing to be creative. I think it's really powerful to be creative for ourselves, for our own path. And so the more artists we have, in my opinion, in the world, the better off we will be as far as that connective piece.
Oh, right. And so, I know that our first guest for Benedictine Conversations this year, he talked about our vocation to beauty and our call to creativity, exactly what you're talking about. And so one of the things he said was the following. He said, we are born to be artists. And he's speaking the way he defined artistry. I'll continue the quote. We are born to be artists and are made in the image of the greatest artist, capital A. Each of us is called or summoned to beauty. Our greatest artistry is to be found in our ability to create peace and harmony with other humans and the rest of creation. What is your response to that?
Well, I think it's a very beautiful quote. It's a very lovely thing to pull out of your conversation with him. Yeah, I think a couple of things. I think that the idea that we're all born artists really ties deeply into the idea that I think it's a deeply human thing to be creative, for one. Mm-hmm. And for two, through the act of creation, there is an unfolding of ourselves that allows us to be more seen, and not only to be more seen, but to see one another. And through that seeing one another, there is the potential for deeply caring for one another and holding space for one another. Mm-hmm. And I think in that, there is incredible power for sharing this life through art, really. And so that the idea of beauty, when I think of the word beauty, I think of it not only in creations of humans, so thinking about music and thinking about painting or, you know, whatever it is, but I also think being drawn to the beauty of nature. Yeah. And allowing ourselves really to connect with the natural world creates space for that opening that I think happens even with making art. I mean, the awe that comes along with that perception or connection to beauty also is a vulnerability, right? Mm-hmm. That feeling of like openness and connectedness. And that vulnerability is the very thing that makes us realize that we belong to one another, right? Mm-hmm. And that you know, that we need to take care of the earth and we need to take care of each other. So I think that's probably more information than you wanted on my thought on that quote, but no, I think that there's incredible potentials for opening within that concept.
Yeah, and I just kind of wonder when you reference that some of your students are feel funny calling themselves an artist. I wonder if it's because we narrow that definition, you know? So we're talking about expanding that. No, it was, I loved what you just said, that being creative allows us to be seen. I can't remember exactly how you said it, but allows us to be seen in a different way and to see others. Mm-hmm. So with having said that, I'm curious how being an artist has shaped you as a person, how it's impacted your own formation, you know, and your own spirituality, affecting how you see the world and how you see others. If you could speak to that.
How long do you have? I have a lot of things to say about that, but I'll try to keep it short. It's certainly a great privilege, of course, on many levels, to be able to devote time to what I think is inherent in an artist, which is allowing yourself to be open and curious and inquisitive and engage with the world around you. And in some cases for artists, then they take that and they write something. Or for some folks, they take that and they draw something. So that deep listening, I think, to the world and really paying attention in a different way has been, continues to be one of my greatest teachers, in that I continue to be surprised by the awe and the greatness of the world around us. I continue to be surprised and humbled by the amazing people that surround me, because it's a real practice that I've adopted into my life as an artist, to just try to take time to really think about, period. I mean, that probably leans into my academic side as well, but allowing time and space for thought, we really have to work to be able to do that in the society that we live in. I mean, we're very tied as a culture to being busy. Yeah. Right? It's so ingrained for so many reasons, including just to like survive, right? There are real world systems that keep us busy and keep us out of that space. But sometimes it's even just, you know, taking 5 minutes in the morning when the sun's coming up, whenever it happens to be coming up, and just witnessing that, the roll over into a new day, that draw of that beauty. It still sometimes makes me takes my breath away. That I get to witness that, right? And so I think that probably sounds much more philosophical and broad than you wanted, but that really feels like where my work comes from, is spending time just looking and listening with the ear of my heart, really listening deeply. And when I can, because like I said, we're all busy, and trying to not say I should be doing this, or I should be doing that, or I need to do more of that. And instead just taking it, you know, taking that time and space when I can get it, and considering that a gift, really.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think it's probably one of the biggest challenges of our contemporary world, to find that space for reflection. Yeah. Beautiful. Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm curious about your process of creating. We've talked a little bit about it, you and me. And so I'm curious to hear more about that, and really interested in how it has evolved with your own evolution through time.
Yeah. That's a great question. And I will say that it truly has been an evolution. When I started making work, I would say I'd formally been an artist, quote unquote, perhaps for the past 20 years. When I started, I really was drawn to pre-planning a lot, as far as thinking about what my concept is, what the concept is that's driving the work, what will this look like at the end, you know, trying to control all of the aspects of the process, which many artists use that as their working method, and there's nothing wrong with it. But for me, I found that controlling of the process, or that trying to lead the painting, meant that I was really compressing the space for arriving on wonderful surprises, letting you know, the mistakes, quote unquote, the mistakes actually be the thing that leads me. And so probably about 5 years ago, I started really working much more intuitively with my work. And so while it's still concept driven, I would say in some ways even more so, it's much more of me letting the painting lead me rather than vice versa. And so I've actually found that the work is much better when I'm not trying to control it. And also I'm learning from it. I think about it as a seeking, mm-hmm. as a questioning, as a way for my individual, like, one point perspective to understand the world around me. Mm-hmm. And I actually have a couple examples, because who doesn't want to see art when someone talks about art?
Right. It actually sounds almost like a meditative process, you know, mm-hmm. The way you engage in it. I know it's probably not like that for every artist.
Oh, no. And there are a million ways to make paintings. There's no right or wrong way to do that. Mm-hmm. I'm going to share my screen here with you all. Hopefully you're all seeing the painting that is here.
Yes.
So I'm going to start actually with this painting. It's not very often that artists show you work in progress. This is an image from this painting when it was in progress. It's now finished. But I think it's helpful as a space to ruminate upon why my process works for me in the way that it does. And so a lot of my paintings have origin points actually in dreams and in images that come to me in my subconscious. And in some cases, I wonder, you know, if I'm so deep into the practice of making art that some of this intuitive work is just so much a part of me, that's part of the reason that I'm arriving at some of these images. But in addition, it allows for a much more fluid approach to trying to understand the world, and actually even like visioning through my feelings of where I'm at. So oftentimes these paintings really come from a personal place, mm-hmm. but I'm also trying to speak to bigger ideas and issues that I am trying to see my way through, if that makes sense. So this piece, Hope, is a painting that I did. I actually did a smaller piece of it first, maybe about a year ago, and then I dreamt of it again. And so this is a pretty large painting. It's about 4 feet by 3 feet. And I was thinking about, as I was working on it, and as I was working on the initial one too, about what it means to hold hope, and what it means to hold the light of connection between all beings, all of us. And in some ways, this kind of became my meditation for the arrival into the new year. So it's meant to be an image of light, obviously, an image of this drawing together of all of these energies of all the people around us that we love, and nature and all kinds of things, and kind of pulling into that, the orb of stars that's there.
So when you say that it's not finished, what do you mean?
That's a good question. I mean, that is also something we could talk about for a long time. Many artists feel lots of different ways. I have lots of colleagues that have a image and then their painting is finished when it matches the image they plan to make. For me, it is a feeling of doneness, for lack of a better. It feels like I could not do anything else to the piece that I'm working on to enhance the feeling that I'm trying to convey with it. Because even though there are, you know, there's figures and symbols and elements of these works that I think we could talk about a finish in terms of line quality or, you know, how developed it is, the thing I'm really going for is that someone walks away with a connection to it in some way. And so that's almost an intuitive knowing. It's hard to articulate, I think, in terms. So as far as this painting goes, there was just some refining of the feeling of it that happened. And I did bring in a piece that I did finish.
So when you're done, it's just something you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
You don't just say, okay, I'm done.
Yeah. Well, I mean, sometimes that happens too. It's not all roses. I mean, it could certainly, there's always a point in which I think, and I can only speak for myself, that I think maybe I made the last painting that I'm going to make that is doing what I wanted to do. And I mean, there's, you know, there's the greatest highs and the lowest lows in making art. It's a feeling of rightness, a feeling of completion. And I really do think that it comes from a place of making as many paintings as I've made. I'm a pretty prolific painter. And oftentimes the connotation of the word prolific has this like, that you're very great, right? And that's not what I'm trying to intend with that word. I just make a lot of work.
You do a lot of
work. Because I make so much work, I mean, even when I was in graduate school, folks joked about, one person in particular joked about how it was my Midwestern work ethic that I just like make a lot. But I make a lot because it helps me to understand the world and helps me to process it. It is good for my mental health. It is good for my soul to do it. Mm-hmm. And so.
Beautiful. It's stunning. Just stunning.
Thank you so much. It was interesting when you and I were talking before about process. I had shown you this painting and then this painting to show you kind of and this is a finished piece, but it is quite different in feeling. But I was thinking about, I mean, these are back-to-back paintings. This was the most recent painting before that painting I showed you previously. And thought about how interesting it was that there are two paintings that are a holding, right? They're a carrying, but how different I think that they are.
Mm-hmm.
And this piece is actually on, if anyone is physically able to come up to St. Scholastica's campus, this is in Storm's atrium, right below the window.
How big is this one?
It's 4 feet by 3 feet, so it's pretty big.
Yeah. So, I know we talked about this, but there might be a lot of people out there wondering, could you say something about the skeleton?
Yeah, absolutely. So this piece is actually the third piece in a series of work, which is a little unfair for me to say without showing you all, but email me after if you want to see them all. I'm happy to share them with you. But what I was thinking about, and I promise I'll get to the skull in a minute. What I was thinking about when I was making these pieces is I was thinking about all the things that we carry as humans in this world, as far as the things we carry with us that are our personal experiences, our faith, our connection to all of us, all of the people around us, but we also carry like an ancestral lineage, the folks that have come before us. Mm-hmm. And we also carry, or at least I feel like I'm carrying, ideas and feelings about what it means to be a good ancestor to folks that will be coming after us. Mm-hmm. And as I was working through these ideas, I was thinking about how in some ways the process for me has been an unearthing. The first piece has an unearthing of finding this and saying, we should probably have an awareness of this. And the second piece is actually of a grandmother figure that's carrying it. So I was thinking about the grandmothers of my grandmothers that have carried the same things that I'm thinking about carrying. Mm-hmm. And in this piece, it's meant to be a feeling of embracing it and being at peace and holding it, right? And the whole and knowing it is part of all of the pain, all of the beauty, all of the darkness, all of the light. It is part of us, whether you realize we're carrying it or not. And so it's figuring out how to hold it and think about it moving forward. And so you'll see within this, there's all kinds of symbols of life and creation and death and certainly connections to the trees on the top and the roots down below, the feeling that it's this organic form that's basically kind of growing out of the earth. And certainly thinking about us as humans, as individuals, as part of nature was something I was thinking about a lot as part of that as well. And the healing, taking care of nature, caring for nature is really taking care of ourselves, right? Like there's a direct correlation to how the environment is doing versus how it will affect us. But I started including skulls in my work maybe 2 or 3 years ago, because for me, there is something so beautiful in the concept of that permanence and that connection that comes from thinking about our interior bones. And so for me, it's a symbol of the folks that have come before us, the folks that will come after us and ourselves. And so it's an interesting symbol to use because some folks think of it as very dark. Mm-hmm. And I know that going into any painting, people are going to interpret things however they're going to interpret things. And that's good. Everyone should have different points of views and perspectives on art. That's, I think, part of the power of art is that we bring ourselves to it, right? Mm-hmm. But also, I think it's interesting to know, you know, that an artist can know that when they put an object in a painting that it could be read. I know that skull can be read as death, as a symbol of death. Mm-hmm. And I'm okay with the dark connotation as well as the light.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's beautiful. When I first saw this, I didn't notice one thing I'm looking at tonight. That's why I think that we could use this painting in one of our Visio Divina prayer services, actually. But it's almost like... The connections and the roots and so forth continue on her dress. Yes. And they're a part of her.
Yes.
Which is quite lovely.
Thank you.
Yeah.
As I said, and not to be redundant, but I mean, because we are intricately connected to nature. Mm-hmm. There's parts of our bodies that look just like the natural world, right? Like rivers. Yes. Trees. I mean, we can see them in our body. And so it's so strange to me that culturally, it seems like particularly Western, you know, colonist culture is connected to it being that we're separate or other than nature. And we can, and in doing that, we can take advantage of it and not care for it, right?
Right, right. Exactly. Yeah. Beautiful.
Thank you.
Thank you for showing us those.
Yeah.
You know, you said something a little bit ago about being called to teach. So I'm assuming you feel called as an artist, but I don't want to put words in your mouth. So if you could speak to that, do you feel called?
I do. I feel called. And for a long time, I think that I was questioning of that calling in part because making art and putting oneself out there feels in some ways very centering, right? That my experience is important, which I wonder, I think about that, about how, you know, if that has something to do with gender dynamics in the world and about, you know, thinking about patriarchal structures and how much, you know, like it's better to be quiet and unseen, or, you know, like even though those are not very loudly spoken in the world, that certainly thinking about my gender identity and how I move through the world and how that affects my art is an interesting thing to think about. But I digress. I think really in the past, oh, maybe 10 years, I've felt like I can step more and more into it. And the more I step into that calling, and same thing with teaching as well, the better I think, I don't want to say the better I become in it, but the more it reinforces that it's my vocation or calling, that I am meant, I'm as much as anyone can be meant to do something, it feels like whether or not I was would be showing it to the world, you know, exhibiting or whatever it is, I would still be called to be creating and making. And so the external nature of it, as far as putting it out there for the world, is a whole other level. But I think I'm certainly called to create and to listen and to think about how the world visually affects me, I think.
Yeah, that makes sense. Thank you for that. I know we're going to be talking about some of your work in the community, Sarah. But before we go there, I wonder if you could just comment on how you see your role as an artist within the larger community, within the world. What does that mean for you as an artist?
You know, it's a really interesting question because it's actually not something I think about, but certainly I think that my role as an artist is to help to create space for other voices to be heard. So whether that's through my teaching or whether that's through my work with the community mural project, I think my practice of being an artist informs me in ways to understand how powerful that connection can be, and that the more space I can create for other folks to be in that act of making, the more connected we will be within our communities and within the world at large. And so I think my role as an artist, I don't think about it as insofar as much as like my importance as an artist, but more so the tools that I have learned being an artist affords me the opportunity to create space for other folks to make. And that is an incredible gift. It really is. I don't know how else to articulate it, but I'm grateful for it every day. I really am. It is wildly incredible to get to see other artists on their path, no matter where they're at on their path, and that I have a hand in helping them on that path. Really, really is kind of overwhelming to think about how fortunate I am to be able to do that.
And I think you're going to talk about that a little bit with the mural project, right? So yeah. do you want to move into whatever it is that you want to show us? Yes.
Yeah. Yep. Here, I will share my screen again. And I also, maybe after we do that, I can speak a little bit to my project with Gary as well.
I feel like
it's so appropriate. Oops. Sorry about that. You'd think I would be very good at sharing my screen, and yet technology sometimes can be challenging. All right. Oops, nope, not that kind of sharing. There we go. Like share. Can everyone see this painting that we've already seen before? Hopefully. Okay. So I'll come back to it, but these are some of the plates from A Common Thirst that I did with Gary. They are more recent than the pieces that we've done as part of our mural project, which we started in 2016 at St. Scholastica. And that's when I took on the role as director of the art program. And when I was thinking about, when I was collaborating with my fellow faculty members, and we were talking about what makes art at St. Scholastica different, of course, embedded in our heritage are the Benedictine values, and the connection to community and the connection to hospitality, and trying to find ways to really see and be seen through respect and dignity. And so both Paula Jeunesse, who is a fellow art professor here, and I have experience doing murals with our own personal practice as artists, and thought that it would be a really powerful thing to bring that to our students, not only so that they can go out and make murals in the world when they learn the whole process, but also to really partner with people in the community to really listen. And instead of taking the idea of here's this painting that you need, which I mean, I will take a painting. Like, paintings are lovely to receive, of course, right? But instead, going in to ask parts of the community, connecting with students in kindergarten all the way through high school, and creating pieces of art for the people, with the people that are going to live with them. So this piece in particular, we did for, we actually unveiled it as part of the Still I Rise concert, which is this wonderful benefit that St. Scholastica Choirs does. But in this case, they were raising money for Safe Haven. And so we created this piece in collaboration and connection with Safe Haven, and which is a women's shelter. In town for their actual shelter, so that it would create peace and beauty in spaces that they needed it. And so this mural was actually worked on by over 100 people in our community, including students, and is permanently installed in Safe Haven, which is really lovely. So it's this piece, and we've done lots of wonderful collaborations with folks in the community. But then another aspect of our mural project is to connect with spaces and places and in our beautiful buildings at St. Scholastica. Oops, too far. And so this piece here, Corin Adama, it lives in the School of Sciences. It's installed in 2018, and Professor Paula Jeunesse and I collaborated on the vision for it with the Dean of the School of Sciences, and really tried to envision the depth and the breadth of all of the things that the folks that graduate from those programs do. And so we came up with this piece. I put in, instead of showing an installation piece, it's beautifully installed. So please go and see it in person if you have not. But I sometimes think it's fun to see the behind the scenes of paintings. So it wasn't quite done at this point, but you can see that the original image, when you're doing collaborative pieces, it's much more helpful to have an image that everybody's working on, because it's the shared experience. And so we had this initial image, and then we're transferring it onto these large paintings. This is a very, mural projects are a very different process than, of course, making individual artwork, but there's something so powerful about our combined experiences of making something that it's the idea of, you know, many together make something better than one individual person can make.
Beautiful.
Thank you. Yep. So we've made, with the mural project, I think we've made 10 murals. Two that we'll be working on this spring, and we brought in some incredible visiting artists that have come in to work with our students, and we've had students that have had the experience of working on a mural in a different place with a different part of our community with a different age of students all 4 years that they're here, and so they leave also with that connection to these places, and also thinking about what public art looks like and how it can really change and affect lives in a powerful way.
That's amazing. It's, yeah, this piece is just, I could stand and look at it for hours, and it, you're right, it is beautifully hung, installed. Yes. Lovely. I would like to remind participants at this time to go ahead and send in any questions or comments that you have. We did get one comment in from Gary, and Gary, I just want to let you know I'm going to do yours in a minute, because it touches on a question I'm going to be asking her in a little bit. So anyone else can send in any comments or questions. So are you going to talk now about Gary's the book? Yeah,
I sure can. Yep, I just didn't want to. Sure what direction.
No, yeah, that's great. That's great.
All right, resharing my screen. All right, so I know you've all had a wonderful presentation already for this series by the amazing Gary Bullhauer, who I consider to be a friend and also an incredible inspiration. He's a wonderful poet, teacher. I cannot tell you how thrilled I was when he asked me to be a part of this project. Usually when you talk about book illustrations and the process, usually their author will bring their book to a publisher, and the publisher will select the illustrator and connect you that way. But Gary brought me on pretty early on, and this felt like a very deeply collaborative and powerful project to be a part of. So this was a project a couple years in the making. He brought me his original story that he ended up paring down quite a bit. But the really wonderful thing for me is I was able to see within his writing all of the different ways he was forming these images through writing. And you don't have images, of course, you're doing that through writing. And then also he really helped to lead me through what he saw as part of this. So it's an incredibly beautiful book. And I also feel very tied to this idea of a common shared interest and connection and seeing one another. It's that seeing thing again that I was talking about, and how powerful it is to be seen and also to see someone truly. And so, yeah, for folks that don't know the book, it's a really beautiful story. That starts out in a really happy place, like many stories do, which this is the opening scene from it. These are the original drawings. I did them at scale. And so when you see the book itself, it looks like it was drawn because it was meant to feel replicated in that way. And so you have the rocky mountains with the goats in it and the plains with the sheep. Pretty lovely, but I thought it would be at least a little interesting to just see how I really did draw these side by side, so that when a child opens the book, it was like opening, you know, the landscape, kind of the landscape unfolding before a child. And also there's a color story that occurs throughout the whole book, in that I was thinking about the littlest of folks that we might be listening to this book and seeing the evolution of the colors as they're going, or even the evolution of the moon moves across the sky. And this, I have to say, my mom really gave me a deep love of reading, but then also reading to my children really helped to inform this practice too. So thinking about all of the ways that the story could be told in addition to the beautiful words that Gary was sharing.
I'm curious, because when you talked earlier about sometimes dreaming your paintings. And we actually had a question come in from Heather. She had said, can you say more about how you create paintings from your dreams? And so it made me wonder, did you dream any of these for this book?
Yeah, that's a good question. And Heather, that's an awesome question. I'm happy to answer that. But as far as this work goes, it wasn't that same sort of sourcing of imagery that happens with my paintings. In fact, for these, I ended up diving into lots of different source material and inspiration. I had the great fortune of teaching in Ireland in spring of 2018. And so you should be able to see, or you might be able to see, some influences of Western Ireland as part of this. I spent a lot of time around sheep. So that was
wow.
great to inform me with that. And then also living on our beautiful North Shore of Superior, I think it's probably more clear in this, the image of the rocks. I was thinking about the rocky promontories, mm-hmm. and I also happen to know lots of wonderful folks with goats that let yeah. me come and sit and do some drawings and take some images. And so this was much more about, I mean, it certainly was collaborative as an act of making art with Gary, mm-hmm. but it was also about really about that shared vision. And so that I think would be formatively just counter to that, the other, a little bit more of an intuitive process. It doesn't mean that that wasn't part of this. It certainly was the arc and the lyrical nature of what I was trying to, I was almost trying to think about the intonation of his voice and the way that this would be read. Mm. But in any case, yes. And one little note that I just want to bring up, which is one of my very favorite things. So this is done in colored pencils.
Okay.
Which, if you've ever used colored pencils, you'll know that they're pretty laborious as far as time goes.
Yeah.
But that is not why I use them. I use them because I thought about kids and how often kids get a pack of colored pencils as part of their school supplies. Mm-hmm. And I wanted a kid to look at this and say, I could do that.
Ah.
Like that there's a teaching kind of as part of that, to say that they can connect to the materials it's made of. And so therefore they can imagine how it might have been made. Does uh-huh. that make sense? So
yeah.
that's why I end up taking on the colored pencil challenge. But I think
yeah.
it also made the colors just really robust and beautiful.
It's amazing. We had a question come in. You mentioned Lake Superior a second ago. Elizabeth asks, how much of your inspiration comes from Lake Superior? I know that my soul is moved every time I'm able to be near her.
Oh, I am inspired by Lake Superior every day, even when it's the frozen tundra.
Yeah.
I mean, I think for me, it's a deeply spiritual, like soul-filling place. To even just regard, right, to look at it every day feels mm-hmm. like a gift for sure. I think I'm inspired by the feelings of Lake Superior.
Yeah.
Certainly I'm not a landscape painter, but the feeling I get from the lake, I think, is imbued in a lot of my work for mm-hmm. sure. That's a great question. I concur, Elizabeth. It's a wonderful, you know, part of our world that we get to be inspired by. So fortunate.
Well, speaking of Gary Bolhauer, I'm going to move to his question now. He harkens back to the skull, and he says, for me, the skull also is a clear symbol of our mortality, our limitedness, our finiteness. As far as we know, we are the only species that has an awareness of our own impending death. It is one of the realizations that we uniquely carry. Your paintings always bring me to wonder, to amazement, to deep questions and realizations. Your art is an incredible gift to the world. Can you talk more about your own practices that allow you to listen to the world and to your own heart?
Well, first, that was incredibly beautiful. Thank you, Carrie, for saying that. I feel deeply blessed to actually make the work that I do. You know, I think that for me, it's spending a lot of time being quiet. I spend quite a bit of time walking around in the woods by myself, just listening and breathing and just trying to get somewhat quiet. I think that that lays the groundwork for that. Then when I go into the studio, I have, I don't know, it's almost like a gathering. I've gathered all of this space with which to then create. It's really hard to articulate, but I think that's part of it. I also am always kind of like thinking about things in terms of images, thinking about things in terms of painting, thinking of in composition and colors and textures, thinking about what it makes me feel, how I'm connecting to it. And so I think that that act of, it's like a practice of mm-hmm. awareness, mm-hmm. I think that's where it comes from. Obviously, I'm not being incredibly articulate about it, but I think that's because it's something I don't have a lot of words for, but I do have a lot of feelings for, and it's an innate sense of held knowing that allows me to just trust that what I'm making is going somewhere or doing something.
I'm going to go ahead and come out of the sharing if that's okay.
That's fine. Yep.
Okay. We've talked a little bit about the inner artist thing that I kind of believe that we each have an inner artist. We've talked about human beings. That's kind of our vocation, you know, to be creative. We have that ability to be creative. So those kinds of practices, like that deep listening, being out in nature, do you think those are things that would work for other people?
Yes.
To sort of nurture that inner artist?
I think so. I think that oftentimes we feel like we have to do something big, right? That it has to be like, I'm going to make a painting or I'm going to make a sculpture. And that's what an artist is. And of course, that can be an artist. But I sometimes think it is going out into nature and saying, I'm going to take 5 minutes to just stand in wonder of what's going on around me. And so in some cases, I think that it can be really surprising to spend time really just looking at something, looking at the bark on a tree, for example. Maybe be careful about where you're doing that because people will be like, oh, what's happening here? But I mean, I digress. There's a creative practice, I think, in just bearing witness to what's around us and further than taking what you saw, taking what it made you feel and bringing it into a creation of some form. And so for some folks that could be doodling, for other folks it could be writing down a couple words, things you smell, what the air quality was doing, what, you know, the sensory experience of it. Mm-hmm. I think that investigation can be really powerful for a creative mm-hmm. practice. And so if I was going to say, you know, what is something that you could do to nurture your inner artist? I think it would be giving yourself just 5 minutes a day that you're not doing something, that it's not an act of needing to complete something. It is an act of just being and seeing what you notice if you stand somewhere for 5 minutes or look at something for 5 minutes. Our attention spans have been so trained to move past things, right? With all the screens and things we have going. And there, that I don't think that that's all bad, but that idea of giving ourselves just time or, you know, spending time and looking at the reflections on the top of your coffee or your tea, right? just looking to see what shapes and form, and letting that be a space for meditation, and thinking about, you know, the steam that's coming off it, and, you know, what kind of smells are in the space that you're in, and what is the light doing? I think that's a very creative thing to do, and is doable, I think, for just about anyone that just can spare 5 minutes of time. And I think if you hold that into a practice that I'm just going to do this for a week and see what happens, interested to see from like a Monday to a Friday, what, you know, how that even affects your breath, your breathing, and how that affects, you know, your worldview, I think, at large.
Thank you. Thank you for that. I'm aware that we're at our time, but I have one question I really have to ask you. And Greg Spofford wrote in, and his question has to do with what I was going to ask. So what Greg says is, Sarah, your spirit, your soul is so wonderfully evident in your past and present service as both an artist and an educator. And then he said, what are your dreams for the future, meaning hope for the future? And so my question was, because you entitled this evening's event, Sacred Selves, Creating and Becoming. So I, like Greg, am wondering, what is Sarah becoming? What are you becoming?
Well, it's a great mystery, right? Like that's right. A really wonderful thing. No, I mean, I that sounds very facetious, and thank you, Greg, for that. That's really wonderful. For me, as I have progressed in making art and actually just progressed as a human, I have found the greatest gift is that we evolve so much. We grow into ourselves in so many different ways. And so I have just found, as I'm thinking about the future, that I really want to find space to delight in that. Yeah. I mean, there is certainly a lot of pain and struggle that we are all experiencing in our lives. I mean, that is just part of being human, but especially part of being human in the world right now, it seems.
Yeah.
But I think what I would love, as far as visioning forward goes, is to just to allow a little more space to allow that becoming. So the reason I titled that is I think that through creating, we're all in the process of becoming, we're all in the process of evolving. And I think that is beautiful. We're not in stasis. We're not fully made, right? We're continuing to grow. And I think that there's such a richness and a power into just being open to the mystery of what, you know, what is coming next for us. This is a hard time for that also, but there's also some beautiful bits that I think are a part of that. And so for me, I will continue teaching, continue painting, and see what I can share with the world, really. It is a deeply great gift that I get to do what I do.
Sarah, this has been a delight. And I can't believe how quickly the hour went, but regrettably we're at our time. And so I want to first thank all our participants for being with us here tonight for this wonderful conversation. Thank you for the great comments and questions that came in for Sarah. And I would like to give you a sneak peek at our next Benedictine conversation, which will be on February 15th with Father James Martin, a Jesuit. So registration links will be coming out for that. And Sarah, I want to come back to you now and see what you'd like to leave us with tonight.
Thank you. And thank you for this wonderful conversation. It's been really just a great joy. I brought with me just a small thing to offer you all as you head off into whatever is next for you. I am deeply inspired by poetry, and I think it's pretty common for artists to be inspired by other artists. I'm certainly inspired by Gary's work. I'm inspired by Mary Oliver, who some of you might be familiar with. I'm inspired by Ross Gay. And really inspired by Joy Harjo, who is the poet laureate of the United States, incredible poet. In fact, she came virtually to the area this fall, and just incredible. And so I actually want to leave you with, I'm going to read this poem for you, and then I'll show you the painting, just as the very last note that came to me through her incredible work. So I'm going to read you a poem, and I'm not a poet, so please forgive me, poets in the room, but I am a deep appreciator of poetry, and so hopefully you can hear that in my words. And so this piece is called Remember. It was written in 1983 by Joy Harjo, as I said, the poet laureate, and it's from her book, She Had Some Horses. Remember the sky that you were born under. Know each of the stars' stories. Remember the moon. Know who she is. Remember the sun's birth at dawn. That is the strongest point of time. Remember sundown and the giving away to night. Remember your birth, how your mother struggled to give you form and breath. You are evidence of her life and her mother's and hers. Remember your father, he is your life too. Remember the earth whose skin you are, red earth, black earth, yellow earth, white earth, brown earth, we are earth. Remember the plants, trees, animal life, who all have had their tribes, their families, their histories too. Talk to them, listen to them. Mm-hmm. They are alive poems. Remember the wind, remember her voice. She knows the origin of this universe. Mm-hmm. Remember, you are all people and all people are you. Remember, you are this universe and this universe is you. Remember, all is in motion, is growing as you. Remember, language comes from this. Remember, the dance language is that life is. Remember.
Beautiful.
Isn't it stunningly beautiful? She's so incredible. We're so lucky to be able to hear her work and read her work. I just want to show you really quick the piece that is. Great. So this is the piece that I did that came from that her incredible gift, and then inspired me to make this piece. So find inspiration everywhere, and also remember, right?
Remember. Sarah, thank you. Thank you so much. This has been very beautiful. And to all of you out there, on behalf of the Sisters of St. Scholastica and the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, we wish you and your loved ones peace and many blessings. Thank you so much. Good night, everyone.